about empirical evidence. And he just would not receive the evidence of the scriptures. He believed that Jesus was a historical figure, but he did not believe that Jesus was God or that Jesus was needed for his sins in order for him to get to heaven. And it was a lengthy conversation. And what I found interesting is that there were Christians who chimed in and once in a while said things like, well, you know, there are other beliefs and we need to respect them too. And I thought, no, there are not other beliefs that lead to Christ. There's only one belief. And so I don't know what kind of Christianity you believe in. There are Christians then who said, I don't know what this whole conversation was about. You can't force anybody to believe. And I wasn't trying to force him. I left him with the opportunity, hey, just seek the Lord and he's going to direct you. He's going to open up your eyes. I wasn't trying to force him. I was trying to give him evidence, but they felt as though they were forced because they bought into the whole political sensitivity, you know, correctness idea, you know, you're offending people. When in reality, I'm giving him information. I'm trying to answer his questions and so forth. And that's sad when Christians can't even stand on the same platform together and fight together. You know, the enemy can do it. He does it very well, but the Christians can't for some reason. This morning's message is in Matthew chapter 16. So if you'll turn there, we'll pray and we'll get into it. Father in heaven, we come before you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who died on the cross for our sins, who we put our faith and trust in and nothing else. For it is by grace through faith that we are saved, Lord. And because we are saved, we become born again. The Word of God has divided the soul and the spirit that comes alive within our bodies and now desires and hungers for the things of God, for the Word of God, and for the work of God, Lord. And I pray, Lord, that you begin to divide the lines, Lord, in our lives. Lord, that we would do some self-checking, some inventory, Lord. Where are we at in our walk? Why are we doing the things that we're doing? And what are we doing for the kingdom of God? May your spirit take a hold of us, Lord. In the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Amen. Matthew chapter 16, we're going to look at verses 1 through 12. This morning's theme is heaven's sign. Heaven's sign. You know, men are looking for a sign, but they're looking for a sign so great that it would be undeniable. Undeniable. Healing, a cough, it's not enough. A fever, that won't do. Cancer, no. Okay, but you know, we have doctors. They give medicine and so forth. A dead body returning to life, maybe, but I don't think so. You can explain these things away, right? And they do. They explain them away. Well, he really wasn't dead. Even though a minute and a half went by, you know, he was still there and then he came back to life through the doctors, you know, shocking his heart and so forth. You know, I've had people say, unless I see Jesus standing in front of me, I will not believe. Well, Jesus stood in front of many people and they did not believe. They did not believe. Jesus will come a second time and he will stand in front of many, but it'll be too late for them to repent and turn to God. Most versions of the Nicene Creed, which is a statement of Christian belief by our early fathers, they said this concerning his second coming, including the following statement. He ascended into heaven. He's seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. A statement of faith. And in that statement of faith, they were very clear that when Jesus comes back again and he stands before you as a sign to his authority and his power and authenticity, he says, I will judge the living and the dead. It is too late by then. Now is a day of salvation. Today is a day that we need to commit our lives to the Lord. And we need to get serious about it. This morning, I'm going to share with you three things. A sign from heaven is what they were looking for, and a sign from heaven they will get. And that is the resurrection, my second point. And I think that gives us the empirical evidence that God does exist and that the resurrection did happen, being seen and experienced by over 500 people. And then the last thing is bad doctrine, that is of the religious leaders. Let's look at the context here so we understand what we're getting into. We're going to see the Pharisees and Sadducees, who were oftentimes enemies against each other, just did not disagree, but for this one situation, they're going to unite, and they're going to attack in unity Christ Jesus. In fact, they are going to attempt to murder him and succeed. Both groups demand a sign to authenticate his credentials as the Messiah. And Jesus is already performing many, many signs before them, which were not evident enough for them as they refused him. And then in the latter verses, 5 through 12, Jesus warns his disciples about the false teachings of these Jewish leaders here. So we're going to look at verses 1 through 12 this morning. Let's go ahead and start and read the context here of verses 1 through 4. It says, the Pharisees and Sadducees came testing him, Jesus, asking that he would show them a sign from heaven. And he answered and said to them, when it is evening, you say, it will be fair weather, for the sky is red, and in the morning it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and threatening. He says, hypocrites, you know how to discern the face of the sky, but you cannot discern the signs of the times. A wicked and adulterous generation seeks after a sign, and no sign shall be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. And he left and then departed from them. As he confronts the religious leaders, calling them hypocrites, Mark also tells us in chapter 8, verses 1 through 11, the same scenario that was brought to Jesus. The religious leaders, the Pharisees and Sadducees, came to test Jesus, asking him to show a sign from heaven. The Sadducees and the Pharisees were long-standing enemies, no doubt. And in fact, they came together just because of Jesus Christ, because of the seriousness that they felt against their whole system. We've seen this in our community today. We had an issue, several years ago, Proposition 8, and it seemed like all the religious groups came together. Whether you were Christian, whether you were Catholic, whether you were Mormon, whether you were Jehovah Witnesses, they were gathering them all together to picket against this one initiative. And it worked. We got the votes. But unfortunately, the enemy won because he controls the government, and they decided that they didn't care what we voted, and they went ahead and initiated it anyway. But it's interesting how religious people will get together when they find a common enemy against them. And this is exactly what's going on here. They just could not allow it to happen, and so they're going to do everything they can to stop Jesus. So they were keeping a close eye on him, and they followed him everywhere he went, sending spies, I am sure. And these groups are of the religious elite, and they have plenty of resources to do these things. And the Pharisees believed in the resurrection, yet the Sadducees did not believe in the resurrection. They were contrary to it. These two groups were contrary to one another. You could compare them to some of our liberal churches today and some of our legalistic churches. Our liberal churches are churches that call themselves Christians, but they allow same-sex marriage within their church. They reject the resurrection of Jesus Christ. They even reject the scriptures. Well, we're not really sure if all the scriptures are from God, so we wrote a book and we'll tell you which scriptures are from God and what scriptures are not from God. And so you have to believe their interpretation. These are the liberals. They reject the deity of Jesus Christ. Oh, no, he can't be God. Some may even go to the point and say, well, he became God. He was a man, but then through the death and the crucifixion and then the resurrection and ascending, descending into hell and so forth, he was born again and he ended up becoming God. And they come up with these wacky ideas because they're liberal and they just open their arms to any thought whatsoever, and they're not gonna offend you, and so they kind of receive it. And on the contrary end, you have the conservatives, the very legalistic groups that have rules for everything, right? Well, you have to go to church on the Sabbath day, which is a Saturday, not a Sunday. And you can't eat certain meats and foods and fish and so forth, because God has given us a law in the Old Testament. And you can't have tattoos either. So shame on you for having tattoos. And they come up with all these rules. And I remember earlier in my walk, there were some churches that were very legalistic. They'd even tell you what to wear. Women had to wear long dresses. And they had to make sure they covered themselves up to their necks and so forth. These were things that were going on in the church. And this is what's going on at the time of Jesus. And they were gathering together because they had a common enemy, and that was now Jesus, and they were going to fight against him. So testing him, they asked if he would show them a sign from heaven. Now the verb here for sign, or testing, I'm sorry, we have to understand. It signifies that they were not sincere in seeking a sign. They really didn't care about the sign. They were more interested in trapping him in this test. You can show us a sign at any time, but we don't care about the sign, but we want you to show us a sign anyway and show us right now. Well, he's been showing them signs all day long, all week long, all over the place. He fed 5,000 men. And then to sequel that, he fed another 4,000 men. Isn't that enough? And so signs were being done in front of their eyes, but they were blinded and they could not see those signs. Because of the hatred, because of their own agenda, they were blinded to those things. In fact, the God of this world has blinded their eyes. 2 Corinthians 4:4 says, whose minds the God of this age has blinded, who do not believe. The enemy has blinded their eyes with anger and envy and hatred. Blindness is caused sometimes from the enemy. Blindness is caused sometimes because we have our own agenda. We have our own plans. And we're not willing to open up our eyes to see what God is doing. And they were blinded. Those who want to see the will of the Lord will see it. And those who don't want to see the will of the Lord won't see it. If you really want to see the will of the Lord, then open up your word, read it, and then start doing it. But if you don't want to see the will of the Lord, then you're not going to seek it. And even if you seek it, you're going to doubt it, whether it's the will of the Lord or not. They were looking for a sign from heaven, such as the calling down of fire from heaven. That would be a great sign. And then we would believe if you'd send a sign like that down from heaven and then take care of the Roman government too and then establish us as a nation. That would be wonderful. They said they were not convinced by the signs of this earth, and so they wanted Jesus to do something spectacular. There was a tradition held that a sign done on earth could be a counterfeit from Satan. But signs done from heaven, that is from the sky down, were assumed to be from God. And they believed that tradition. They wanted a sign. And so my first point, a sign from heaven. What kind of sign would you want from heaven? These religious leaders were looking for more than a typical sign. They were hoping for earth or heaven to touch earth in a dramatic way. Maybe a sign like in Genesis 9:13, where God said, I set my rainbow in the clouds, and it shall be for a sign of the covenant between me and you and the earth. That would be a great sign to give us. Well, he gives it to us all the time. Let it rain, let the sun come out, and we see the beautiful rainbow. Still is a sign to us that God exists. Or maybe they wanted a sign in Revelation 15. Then I saw another sign in heaven, great and marvelous, seven angels having seven last plagues, for in them the wrath of God is complete. We find in Revelation 14 a description of the consummation of all things, as all things are coming to an end. And in the ending, with the fury of the Battle of Armageddon in chapter 15, John describes God's judgment in more detail. Seven angels having the seven last plagues. For in them the wrath of God is complete. Maybe they wanted a sign like that. That would be an awesome sign, right? Especially for believers. There were a couple of disciples who say, Lord, send fire down there. They'll believe then. Signs, wonders, or miracles are like healings, as we discussed last week. They serve a purpose. They serve a purpose. What is that purpose? They're pointing to Jesus being the Messiah. That when the Messiah comes, he would be doing signs and wonders. And that's exactly what signs and wonders spoke of. That Jesus was the Messiah, the one who came to die for the sins of the world, the one that the Old Testament prophets spoke about. So when they saw Jesus doing these signs, and by the way, no one else was doing these signs but Jesus, and not in the quantity that Jesus was doing them either. And so it was very clear to them, they could not deny the signs, they never fought against the signs that he was doing them, they just wanted something greater. But they knew they weren't going to get it, and so they were going to get the opportunity to murder him. The Pharisees showed their hypocrisy when they asked Jesus for a sign. They were obviously not seeking to know Jesus, but had already seen so many proofs that he was the Messiah. Another miraculous work will not change their minds because they had decided already not to believe in him. Their hearts are already hardened. You ever get a child that's heart is hardened? And no matter what you do, you can't convince them because their heart is so hardened. And it needs to be softened. Israel was like that. We see that in Ezekiel and Jeremiah and Isaiah. Their hearts were so hardened. And God said that he had to take their hearts of stone and crush them to make them into hearts of flesh. And I think we need to have that happen to us once in a while. God, just crush our hearts. Make them sensitive again to his truth, to his word. So Jesus, knowing their hearts, refused to give them the sign. There are two words here that we have to define carefully. The first one is the word sign. When the Pharisees asked for a sign, they wanted a miraculous sign. Some miraculous sign that would prove that Jesus was the Savior sent from God. And actually this word sign, simeons, is often translated as the word miracle in the New Testament. That's the other word, miracle. And they're two different words. The sign can be a miracle. However, in several other verses, it refers to some less supernatural event. What they were seeking was supernatural event that's unexplainable that you can look at and say, that is from God. And Jesus wasn't going to give it to them. They asked for that sign. In my younger years, as a believer, I oftentimes would ask God for signs. I'm sure you did the same thing. You know, you come to the Lord Jesus Christ. He's active in your life. You're reading his word and go, Lord, I'm going through this situation. Could you just show me that you're directing me? Could you do something, you know, like send some fire down from heaven? Or could you just speak to me, you know, Lord God? Or would you just, that enemy, Lord, would you just kind of knock him down? Or, you know, you ask for signs all the time. You read of Gideon's sign and how he threw the fleece, you know. And so you do that. You throw a blanket out. Okay, Lord, so when I wake up in the morning, if there's dew on the blanket and nowhere else, then I know, okay, I'm going to go forward with this. Of course, you do that and nothing happens. And we do that because we're, I think, from a sincere heart, looking for God and wanting to make the right decisions, but we foolishly think that God's going to give us a sign when he's already given us his word and how we should follow it. Now, I'm not saying that we should not ask God for direction and ask God to be in the work that we hope to do for God. I believe he's already in it. I think he's in every work that we want to do for God, no matter what you want to do for God. That's the God we serve. Amen. He wants us busy with his work, and so he's going to be involved in it completely. When I seek the Lord's will, I always seek the Lord's will through Joshua chapter 1. I want to make sure that God is telling me first, just as he told Joshua. I want to make sure that leadership is also in actively approving it within the body, because God works within the church, contrary to some beliefs. He uses the church. That's how he functions in the world today and through the leadership. And so I want to make sure leadership is involved in it. And then the people. And those are three things that I look for. And then there's one that I throw in where I look for anything from anyone. It could be a billboard sign. And I'll give you an example. It could be someone just coming up to me and asking me a simple question. When I was going to South Sudan, I think it was Jeff, who called me up one day and said, hey, those guys that came from that ministry, I'm just curious, what was that ministry's name again? And he had no idea that I was going to go to South Sudan. And I said, that's it. That's all I needed was that last confirmation. You know, and I told him it's far-reaching ministry. And to me, that was confirmation that God wanted me to go. Now, I'm feeling like God wants me to go to India. I'm not seeking God for any of those confirmations. I was asking the Lord and just praying about it, and the Lord just says, I've already told you to go. And so now it's like, just go. So now I just feel like I'm going to go. I'm not going to need the confirmation because I know God's going to be in it. He set everything up, and so I'll be going, hopefully in October, to India, the middle part of India, it turns out, and visit some churches over there and hopefully do some teaching and training and see what the Lord will do. But seeking signs I think we need to be careful with that, that we don't put our faith and our trust in the signs, because what if the sign is not really from God and it's from you, you know, or someone else, or from the enemy himself? And that's why I love Joshua, because Joshua is a very clear indication that God is involved in it. God first tells Joshua, you know, I want you to take over. Moses tells Joshua, I want you to take over. Then the people tell Joshua, I want you to take over. So it's very clear of the work of the Lord. And is it a work of the Lord or the work of the enemy? And so I don't necessarily look for signs anymore, because I'm more interested in what the Word of God says. And he's already told us, go to the world and make disciples of men. So where to go? And so sometimes just get up and the Lord opens the door, go through it, see what happens. Remember the nobleman's son who was healed by Jesus reluctantly? In John chapter 4, verse 46 through 48, Jesus had come to Cana of Galilee, and he made water turn into wine. And there was a certain nobleman's son who was sick there in Capernaum. And we heard that Jesus had come out there to Judea. He went to him and implored him to come down and heal his son, because he was at a point of death. And then Jesus said to him, unless you people, I like the way he said, unless you people see signs and wonders, you will by no means believe. He was a little upset. It's like, man, you just want signs and wonders to believe. We find that the Lord Jesus was not pleased with that kind of faith. That was based on miracles as he was with, which was based on the Word of God. He wants our faith and our trust based on the Word of God and not on miracles. It is more honoring to him to believe the thing simply because he said it than because he gives us some visible proof. He really loves the fact that we believe what he says and not wait for some sign or some miracle to take place. And it's so characteristic of us that we want to see before we believe. But the Lord Jesus teaches us that we should first believe and then we will see. What is the one thing that we Christians should be doing above all other things? I believe it's reading the Word of God. And yet, what is the one thing that we don't do and that we should be practicing on a daily basis? What is it? Reading the Word of God. Why is that? I'll tell you why. Because we have an enemy, and he doesn't want us reading the Word of God. He just does not want us to read the Word of God. At the conference yesterday, they were reading a scripture about Revelation chapter 21, when Satan will be cast into the pit of hell along with his angels, and once and for all, for eternity and damnation. And I thought to myself, wow, that's his end. That is his end. He knows it, because he's read through this book. He's heard the messages. He knows that's his end. So he's on a war path right now, right? And it's interesting, because I thought, if that's his end, you know what I'm going to do? I'm going to remind him when he attacks me what his end is. Right? So when he starts attacking me, I'm like, hey, do you know where you're going? You ain't got much time. You're going to the pit of hell. And if I keep reminding him enough, he might leave me alone and go find someone else that's not reading their word, and they'll fall into his traps. I love that, though. Isn't that so cool, right? You know, come attack. Hey, you're going to the pit of hell, you and your friends. I'll keep telling you, it's going to burn. It's going to be on fire for eternity. There's no hope for you. You're telling me that I'm useless? Boy, wait till you get there. You have no power, no authority, and God's going to take you and drop you right in. You think he's going to hang around after hearing that for a while? I don't think so. If I was telling you that, you'd run like crazy. I don't need to hear that from you. And people do all the time. Oh, you're being judgmental. I'm telling you the truth. He's going to hell. He is. The Word of God. And yet we don't read it. And that's why we're so confused. That way we're so condemned at times. That's why the enemy comes in and causes confusion in the church itself. Because we're not in the Word of God, doing the Word of God. No, first believe what he has said, and then watch what he shows you. That's amazing. Don't test him, trust him, and then see what he does. So in verse 2, he said, as he answers them, so Jesus is going to give them a stern warning here. When it is evening, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red, and in the morning it will be foul weather today, for the sky is red and threatening. So they could kind of tell what kind of weather they were having by what they saw out there, right? They could determine it to a certain point. And he says, you guys do a good job at that, and you're a hypocrite. You're all hypocrites. You all put on your mask. And I've given you plenty of signs, and yet you did not get it. You're living in hypocrisy. Now, Jesus wasn't the only one that noticed this. There actually was a proverb back then that said that if all the hypocrites of the world were divided into 10 parts, Jerusalem would contain 9/10 of those hypocrites. And rightly so, when you look at what they were doing in Jerusalem. I mean, if you were a farmer and you came into Jerusalem to offer up your sacrifice, your yearly sacrifice, and you spent your whole time because you had to make sure that that sacrifice was perfect, pure, without blemish, and you spent all of your time to make sure that that was done. And you bring it to Jerusalem and then you give it to the guy. He inspects it and says, oh, you got a blemish. And it's all a scam by the religious leaders because then they take that lamb and then they tell you it's a blemish. We'll take it away from you, but we'll sell you one of ours that we've already sealed and certified for you. You have to buy it. And it was all a scam. Then they take yours, put it in a den, and they go ahead and resell it because they know there's really no blemish. So yeah, a lot of hypocrisy. There's a lot of hypocrisy in religious men. And when you're a religious man, when you're into rules and regulations and traditions and things like this, then you become a hypocrite because you find yourself doing the same thing. When you start accusing someone of something, you'll find out that there are three fingers as you're pointing one, pointing right back at you. Because if you call someone a liar, you better not be lying. If you call someone a thief, you better not have stolen. If you call someone an adulterer, you better not have committed adultery. So the way you judge someone has to be done gently and lovingly and caringly. That's grace, and that's not condemnation. But you're religious like these religious leaders, and of course, there's a lot of hypocrisy going on. Matthew said, you know how to discern the faith of the sky. And they felt confident about predicting the weather, but when it came to the things of the Lord, they could not discern the signs of the times. And they were supposed to be scholars of the Word of God from the Old Testament. They searched the Scriptures, and yet they could not see that they spoke of Jesus Christ because they were so religious. And this is what Jesus said, but you cannot discern the signs of the times. And it's interesting how so many claim to have read the Bible, but really don't even know the Bible. They don't know the Bible. I love what Pastor Chuck has taught me. And Pastor Chuck is the founder of Calvary Chapel. He is the one who started the Calvary Chapels and have built it up to almost 2,200 churches throughout the world. And he has passed away. But I loved his philosophy. He shared one time, as Calvary Chapel, we don't want to be in one extreme or another because you can get into extremes. You can believe way over here, or you can believe way over there. And so when you believe over here, you push all these people away from you. When you believe over here, you push all those people away from you. So at Calvary Chapel, we try to find the middle ground, the balance between it. That's where you want to be. What is the balance? What is the balance? And the balance is grace. But along with grace, we have to follow principles. And so we live by those principles, by grace and not by law or not by liberties, which are two extremes, but finding that balance between them. They searched the Scriptures, but they could not see. Someone said, show me a Bible that is in shambles, and I will show you a man who is not. When that Bible is torn up and written on and highlighted, I'll tell you, that's the man you want serving with you. But if you have a Bible that looks brand new and you open the pages and they all stick together because they've never been used, something's wrong there. They're not using their word. The application of the Bible is the butter on the bread. Applying the Word of God is really where it's all at, and yet it's so difficult because the enemy doesn't want us to do it, and our flesh is weak, and we really don't want to work at it because it's easier to sit and do nothing than it is to get up and do something. It's interesting is one of the guys here that helps with us maintaining the yard. One of the things that we talk about that we just hate doing here, that is closing the gate. This is a simple task, right? You grab two gates, you bring them together, you put the chain around, you lock it, you're done. We actually timed it. Takes about 10 seconds to do. But for some reason in our head, it's like, you get the gate behind me, and I take off, you know? And then, or he takes off, you get the gate behind me, you know? And it's like closing the gate is such a task. Why is that? It's because of our flesh, you know, that menial task, you know, closing the gate, a repetitive action. I don't know how you ladies do it. Wash clothes, wash dishes, cook every single day, every single day. I don't know how you do it. It's so tedious at times. And maybe that's why we need to go out more often, right? Well, of course, in our society today, we go out more often than we cook anymore. Just the way things have turned around. But I don't know how you do it. It does get tedious, but it's our flesh, and it's true of the Word of God. We need to be in the Word of God, reading the Word of God, understanding the Word of God, and then applying the Word of God to our life. We need to start living it. A simple approach to the Word is this: read it, and then do it. It's pretty simple. James says, be doers of the Word and not hearers, only deceiving yourselves. And you are only deceiving yourselves when you're not in the Word of God. This morning I was thinking of Hebrews chapter 4, verse 12, about the Word of God and how it's powerful, it's sharper than any two-edged sword. And then I got stuck. It's able to divide. And then I thought, okay, divide what? And I know it's to divide the intent of the heart, but that's not what the Scripture says. So I went to it and I looked it up. It actually says to divide the soul from the spirit and then the intent. And I'm thinking, wow, I missed that part there. And that's so important. And that's why we need to read it and reread it and go through it and understand it, because we can so simply misinterpret the Scriptures. And so we have to constantly be in it. It's interesting that those who are blind but want to see will see regardless of the obstacles, because they have a hunger and a desire to know God. And those who wish to see, like the Pharisees and scribes and Sadducees, even though they see miracles and happening around them, will not see, because they just really don't want to see the truth. Look at verse 4. Jesus said, a wicked and adulterous generation seeks after a sign. Now, he's not saying that, you know, we shouldn't pray and ask the Lord to lead and guide us. And I don't believe that asking the Lord for confirmation is wrong. But he's talking about this religious groups in this context, that they really don't want the sign. And this is a wicked and adulterous generation, because they're consuming things on their own for their own selfish reasons. A generation here signifies people who lived at this time, and he's speaking to them. And he says, no sign shall be given to it except the sign of the prophet Jonah. Now, Jonah's rescue from the great fish there that swallowed him was a sign that the prophet and his message were from God, right, at that time to the Ninevites, who were the worst Gentiles of that time, horrific people. And the way that he got to that seashore to preach the gospel, definitely God was in it, because the fish swallowed him, spit him out exactly where he needed to be, and he preached the message, and they repented. God was there. And that's the sign that Jesus is speaking about. He's speaking about the sign of Jesus, who would have triumph over death in his resurrection. And although the Pharisees likely did not understand Jesus' statement, they might have recalled it later on after his resurrection. And I believe that there are many religious leaders who came to the Lord after Jesus was seen by over 500 people, 1 Corinthians chapter 15, after his death and burial. Jesus said to them earlier in John chapter 2, verse 19, destroy this temple. And Jesus was referring to himself. And in 3 days, I will raise it up. I will raise it up. No fear of death, right there. Destroy this temple. What will happen? I'll raise it up in 3 days. No worries. He believed it. And he did it. We should believe him. That's the one sign that Jesus promised. And he left them, and it says he departed. You know, signs will never convert a person to Christianity. They just don't work that way. I've had people, like I said, pray, say, unless Jesus is standing right before me. I mean, no, you wouldn't. have a lifestyle and you're living it and you enjoy it and you're not going to give it up. That's the real purpose for you not receiving Christ as your Savior. You don't want to give up those things when God is asking you to give them up. No. Signs and wonders will confirm a convert. They will confirm. Boy, when I got saved, I told myself after reading the Bible within 6 months, I ran through the whole Bible, and just reading all the miracles and the signs and all the things were just mind-blowing to me because I'd never read the Bible before, and I thought, wow, I'm going to see some interesting things. And so I had the approach naturally. It wasn't intended by me. I'm not that smart, but the Spirit moved me to read it, believe it, and then I thought, I'm going to really see some neat things now that I believe. And boy, I have. I have seen healings. I have seen people's lives changed. Amazing stuff that I've seen God do. And that's how it works. Believe, and then God will show you. But if you're this type of person, no, show me first before I believe, then God ain't going to show you anything because you have the wrong heart. The only sign he wants to show you is the resurrection. And I think that's empirical evidence that God has given to us, is the resurrection, my second point. We see Jesus using the story of Jonah to point to the evidence of the resurrection. The only sign that Jesus will give to these religious leaders, in fact, to all the world, is the resurrection of the Son of God. Peter said this, "Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who according to his abundant mercies has begotten us to a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead." That is our living hope right there. If the resurrection did not happen, then Jesus isn't the Savior. And if Jesus isn't the Savior, he's not God. And if he's not God, then we're not saved, then we're all doomed. That is our living hope. That is our evidence, is the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And it's written right here in Scriptures. The resurrection has been called the central doctrine of Christianity. And Paul said that without the resurrection, there would be no gospel at all. The resurrection of Jesus raising himself is one of the greatest miracles in history, showing us that God is immortal, in control over life and death, and that when Jesus raised himself from the dead after 3 days in decay and bondage, this indeed was a great sign, a miracle. After Christ's resurrection, he took the time to show himself to many individuals, including Thomas. Thomas had doubted Jesus' resurrection. And Jesus' nailed, scarred hands, pierced side was obviously a sign to Thomas because Thomas was in doubt. So Jesus invited Thomas to inspect the marks of the crucifixion using the same language that Thomas used earlier, affirming his unbelief. And Thomas believed. He fell to his knees and he began to worship Jesus. We even see the Apostle John led to belief in the resurrection itself as he looked into the tomb and saw that it was empty. And he believed. Jesus shows us that indeed there is life after death, everlasting life when we choose to believe in him. Jesus said in John 11:25, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live." That doesn't make any sense. If I die, I shall live because I believe in him, because the resurrection is the evidence that I shall live if I are to die today. This was the sign of the prophet Jonah, and he left them, and they departed because they did not understand. And now this is the setup for the next few verses here in 5 through 12. It says, Jesus left without performing a sign for the religious leaders. And verse 5 says, "Now when Jesus' disciples had come to the other side," that is, they went to Galilee, "they had forgotten to take some bread." You remember he had fed 4,000 people. Jesus takes the opportunity to enlighten them with some truth here, since they just encountered the religious leaders. Jesus and his 12 disciples obviously got into a boat. They rowed over to the other side of the Sea of Galilee. And Matthew says they forgot bread. And verse 6 says, "Jesus said to the disciples, take heed and beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and the Sadducees." Now Jesus, being a rabbi, he's warning his disciples. And a good pastor will warn his congregation, because he loves them. He will teach them and equip them and share with them truth because he loves them. Jesus loves his disciples. And there's a work to be done. And so he's equipping them for the work of the ministry. And so he warns them to take heed, to beware of these religious groups or any other teaching contrary to sound doctrine, that is the word of God. Beware of what the doctrine of the religious leaders are teaching. There are so many people who will try to make or try not to make judgment on people, right? Well, I can't judge and I don't want to judge. The Bible's very clear, I don't want to judge. And they stay away from judging all the time. And they base this judgment on scriptures that they haven't even read in their Bible because someone else used it. And so they used it. The Bible says, judge not, lest you be judged. Well, why don't you keep reading? They use that Matthew 7:1, judge not that you be not judged. Well, I don't want to be judged, so I don't judge. And I hear Christians using it all the time. Well, I don't want to judge. You know the word judge is used 63 times in the Bible? That's a lot of times in the Bible. It's used quite a bit. John chapter 7 verse 24 says, do not judge according to appearance, but judge with righteous judgment. Now there it's telling us to judge. What's up with that? Is it contradicting itself? No. If you go back to verse 2 of chapter 7, you'll see that we have a right to judge. We just have to judge rightly. Don't judge according to appearance. Judge a righteous judgment. Use your knowledge. Use some wisdom. Do some investigation before you just spit out a judgment. Look at John 7:51 says, does not the law or our law judge a man before it hears him and knows what he is doing? Well, of course not. We want to hear the information, get the facts, and then we make our judgment calls. We do it today all the time. John 8:15, you judge according to the flesh. I judge no one. Well, wait a minute. I thought we're to judge. Well, not according to the flesh. Use some wisdom. Romans 14:13, therefore let us not judge one another anymore, but rather resolve this, not to put a stumbling block or cause to fall in a brother's way. And so when we judge rightly. We judge with gentleness. We judge with sensitivity. We judge with knowledge and understanding to make those judgments. Do we always hit it? No, we don't always hit it. And that's why we ask for forgiveness too when we judge wrongly. 1 Corinthians chapter 5 is very clear how we ought to judge. You know, we don't even judge the world. The world's already condemned, by the way. You know that, right? John chapter 13, chapter 3 tells us. It's condemned already. So what's to judge? It's like going to a prisoner. I condemn you. Oh, okay. I've been in here for 30 years condemned, but if you that makes you feel good, okay. It's like telling the world, I condemn you. No, they're already condemned. So we don't judge the outside. We judge what? The inside. Who's the inside? We're the inside. We're the inside man. We know Jesus. We know God. We're judging one another constantly. Why? Because we want each other to walk rightly. Serve the Lord. Be busy about our Father's business. Do the right thing. Walk the right way. Stop drinking. Stop taking drugs. Don't wear that kind of dress. Don't do that. I mean, yeah, those can become all kinds of rules and stuff like that, but we need to consider them and say, boy, am I representing Christ correctly here? Because I'm getting a lot of judgment calls on me, and maybe I need to look at myself a little bit here. And of course, those judgments should be done with grace and with gentleness too. Now, Jesus uses a parabolic expression in the word yeast here. Yeast or leaven typically symbolizes sin or impurities in the Bible. And Jesus teaches the importance of being on guard against false teachings. Look at verse 7. The disciples did not understand. So now they're thinking on the earthly plane, right? And so they reasoned among themselves saying, it is because we have taken no bread with us. They're thinking the yeast and bread, and Jesus is thinking of the teaching, and they're missing the whole point. Of course, when you're a hungry man, you can't think of anything, right? Where's dinner? Because I can't think of another thing until I got dinner and food in my belly. And then let's talk spiritual things. Jesus goes on and says, in verse 8, being aware of it, he said to them, now Jesus knows. He knows the heart of men, and he knows they were struggling with each other, right? They're not. I can almost see Jesus, they're not getting it, Lord. Father, they're not getting it. Okay. Let me see if I can do this another way, Father. Give me some words here and how to teach them, right? So he says to them, you have little faith. Why do you reason among yourselves because you have brought no bread? Do you not yet words, you're misunderstanding. Don't you? I just gave you as much bread as you wanted. You ate till your bellies were full. And now you think bringing bread's going to keep you fed? I'll just do it again. Don't you know that? I'm not talking about the physical belly here. Here and in verse 11, it says, how is it you do not understand that I did not speak to you concerning bread, but beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees? In verse 12, then they understood that he did not tell them to beware of the leaven of the bread, but of the doctrine of the Pharisees and Sadducees. He uses the word understand here several times. He uses it 14 times in the New Testament. It's obvious that Jesus wants you to understand the Word of God. He wants you to have an understanding of it, and you can't have an understanding unless you read it, unless you study it. And that's what we do on Sunday mornings. You know, I encourage you, if you don't have a Bible, get one, first of all, and start marking it up. And if you have a Bible, then get a notebook and start writing notes and referencing it to the Scriptures and writing down quotes and writing down principles and writing down philosophies and things like that. What is the central theme and principle within the Calvary Chapel movement? What is the central thing that all Calvary Chapels really, really believe? And I've taught this forever. What is it? Is it spiritual gifts? Is it speaking in tongues? Is it money? Is that the focus? Is it the Word of God? It's the Word of God. That is the central point. That is our main thing within Calvary Chapel, is the Word of God. And do we do topical? No. We go through the Word of God, book by book, chapter by chapter, verse by verse, boom, all the way through. And I, for one, am enjoying the fact that I can slow down now. There was a time where I did a chapter on a Sunday morning. Right now we do chapters on Wednesday. So if you want chapters, come on Wednesday night and you're going to get through. We're almost done with the book of Genesis. You get a whole chapter there. But on Sundays, I am enjoying going a little bit slower to really bring out more, dig into it a little bit deeper. And I encourage you to read through the whole book of Matthew. If you want to go a little faster, read through it and then come back and say, okay, now let me dig out some more, because there is so much to dig out. And I know this is just a few verses and we've already spent an hour here, but I'll get you home before the Super Bowl at 3:30. You'll be home by 3:30, I promise. Look at verse 10. He says, nor the 7 loaves of the 4,000 and how many large baskets you took up. Verse 11, how is it that you do not understand that I did not speak to you concerning material bread, but to beware of the leaven of the Pharisees and Sadducees? And they understood that he did not tell them to beware of the leaven of the bread, so he made it very clear to them, but it was of the doctrine. Bad doctrine. I'm going to close with this. Bad doctrine. There is bad doctrine out there. There is bad teaching out there, obviously, because we have an enemy that does not like us. And that's why we have to be in the Word of God. And bad doctrine is like eating bad food. It really messes you up. I don't know if you've ever had food poisoning, but it's not the funnest thing, especially if you get a really severe food poisoning. And usually when it's food poisoning, you go eat, and almost immediately you're like, oh, something's wrong. Oh, no, I know what it is, because your stomach starts knotting up. And you start running to the throne, and you get on your knees and bow before it, and you give it everything you got. You know exactly what I'm talking about. I mean, that is so, and that's false doctrine. That's false doctrine. You believe it because, you know, it satisfies you, and you kneel before it, and you give it everything you got. This prosperity doctrine is one of those doctrines, because people want to be wealthy. They want to have money. They want to succeed. And so they go towards that type of teaching, hoping to have money and succeed and do whatever it is that they need to do. And they bow before it, and they try to live it and grab as much as they can, but it messes them up. False doctrines are teachings that are added to Scripture or that change the meaning of Scripture. Listen to what Paul told Timothy. Preach the word. That's what he told them. Preach the word. Preach the word. Be ready in season, out of season, convince, rebuke, exhort with all long suffering and teaching. This is what you're supposed to do. This is what pastors are supposed to do. They're to preach the word. to rebuke and to exhort with all longsuffering, not to give up in teaching. For the time will come, listen to this, for the time will come, and I think we're living in that time. Some of you might be sitting here going, when is this going to be over? For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but according to their own desires, because they have itchy ears, they will heap up for themselves teachers, and they will turn their ears away from the truth and be turned aside to fables. There's some churches that realize that the attention span of a person is usually about 15 minutes. And so they'll try to give you 15 minutes, and then they'll break with a joke. And then they'll give you another 15 minutes, and they go, that's it, we're done, because they won't take any more than that. And statistically, the information that's given, you probably retain a small amount. A small amount. And that's why it's important to write notes, write in your Bible, and so forth. At Calvary Chapel, it's like you can just keep going, keep going, keep going. Because you've got people that love the Word of God and want to hear more of the Word of God. Amen? Right? I mean, there are times I go over and people are like, wow, that was quick. That was quick. Yeah, well, we spent an hour, you know? They will go after people that teach the things they want to hear. Paul told Timothy to keep the focus on the Word of God because man, by his natural instinct, does not want God's revelation. They don't want to hear God's Word. They want their own Word. And when a pastor or a leader says the Word of God to someone, people get offended because they don't really want to hear the Word of God. One thing you don't hear in Calvary Chapel, and I already mentioned it to you, is money, right? We don't talk a lot about money, only if it comes within the scriptures as we're going through. But that's an area that people just don't want to hear God. And that's always been an issue. Believe me, I've been 30-something years now, and churches still struggle. You know, tithing is a principle in the Word of God, and yet people don't follow that rule. They make up their own rules, and then that's how they give. That's exactly my point. And so they go and find churches where they can do that. He would rather hear what he wants to hear, something to scratch his itchy ear. And these are teachers who will tell people all day long what they want to hear. Oh, you're so good. You're so wonderful. And God has blessed you. You're sons of God. You're sons of God. And God has blessed you. Go out there. You'll succeed because you're sons of God. Oh, you can't fail, not with God, because God don't fail. He don't pick losers. He picks winners, you know. And this is the kind of stuff. Listen to Paul as he spoke to Timothy in chapter 1, verse 3. I urge you, when I went to Macedonia, remain in Ephesus that you may charge some that they teach no other doctrine. Here at Calvary Chapel, we teach no other doctrine. We go through the Word of God, and we teach Calvary's distinctives. 1 Timothy 2:12 says, I do not permit a woman to teach or to have authority over a man, but to be in silence. Why did I throw that one in there? That's controversial. But it's Scripture. And yet we have churches having women teaching from the pulpit and having authority over man. But that's scriptural. They just kind of run over that scripture and forget it. Itching ears. By the way, why do we have women in the pulpits and pastoring? It's because there's a need being satisfied. There's a feminine woman group that is pushing for equality. And so the church is trying to meet that equality, and so they allow that to happen within the church, even though it's contrary to scriptures. I really believe that. And a lot of things that we do in the church is because we're trying to minister to the culture and trying to reach them. Listen to Paul again in Timothy, and he told a lot to Timothy, who was a young pastor in a young church, and he was equipping him for the work. He says, all scripture is given by inspiration of God and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for in righteousness, that the man of God may be what? Complete, thoroughly equipped for every good work. 2 Peter 2:1 says, but there were also false prophets among people, even as there will be false teachers among you, who will secretly bring in destructive heresies, even denying the Lord, who brought them and bring on themselves swift destruction. And many will follow their destructive ways, because of whom the way of truth will be blasphemy. Covetousness, they will exploit you with deceptive words. For a long time their judgment has not been idle, and their destruction does not slumber. It's coming upon them, these religious leaders and many in today's society. I made a list here. I know I'm going to get in trouble for this, but this is a list of people that I know of, and the list goes on and on. It's a lot longer, but there were people in there that I really never met or studied about that were false teachers. But you may know some of these. Rob Bell. Rob Bell is a false teacher. Rodney Howard Brown, Toronto Blessing. These people were part of the laughter movement. If you're filled with the Holy Spirit, you'll laugh. You'll laugh. Tony Campolo, God, I love Tony Campolo, became more of a social gospel now, and not the word of God. Morris Cirillo, prosperity doctrine. Kenneth and Gloria Copeland, prosperity doctrine. Paul and Jan Crouch, prosperity doctrine. Cirillo Dollar, Jesse DuPont, funny guy, prosperity doctrine, false. Ted Hager, prosperity doctrine, turned homosexual, lost his ministry. Kenneth Hagin, prosperity doctrine. Bill Hybel, emerging church, tried to reach the church with carnal means, cultural means, and found out he didn't make any disciples at all of Jesus Christ. T.D. Jake, great orator, but he doesn't believe in the Trinity. Brian McLaren, Clarence McLean, Joyce Myers, prosperity doctrine. Mike Murdoch, Rod Parsley, Norman Vincent Peale. I used to listen to that guy in the earlier days. False doctrine. Peter Pockoff, Freddie Price, Joseph Prince, Paula White, who's very close friends with our president, Ted White, her husband, and then the famous, well-known Oprah Winfrey, false prophets. These are all false prophets. They're around us, and they have been heaped up. Why do you think they exist? Because people go to them. They're satisfying their ears, and they're supporting them. And yet the truth struggles every day to get support. Isn't that strange? We have an enemy. But he's doomed. The enemy is going to the pit of hell, him and his angels, and they're going to burn forever, the Bible says. And God is going to cast them in there, and we're going to remind him every time we see him what his destiny is and what our destiny is. This earth, we are sojourners. Our home is in heaven, eternally with the Father. Let's pray. Heavenly Lord, we thank you, Father, that we have a proven word true to us, the Bible.